on the right hand. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give in this matter before the court today will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help God?
I do so swear.
Would you state your name for the record, please?
Yes, my name is Vickie Neikirk.
All right. And Ms. Neikirk, what role do you have with the county? What job do you hold?
I currently serve as the Chief Financial Officer for Dawson County Government.
You're the CFO for the county?
Yes, sir.
Head of the Finance Department?
Yes, sir.
And just in a very general way, would you tell the court what your background is that has led you in terms of experience and training to hold that post?
Okay. I have a bachelor's degree in business administration with a double major in finance and management. I am also a certified through the Carl Vinson Institute, level 2 certified government finance officer. And I have worked in local government since 2001 in the finance departments of various governments.
And what did you do before 2001?
I worked in banking.
How long have you held the position of CFO here in Dawson County?
Since April of 2016.
So having come on board in spring of 2016, did you take part in the formulation of the 2017 fiscal year budget for the county?
Yes, sir, I did.
And then you also took part, I take it, in the 2017 work to prepare the 2018 fiscal year budget?
Yes, sir.
Tell the court, in a very general way, what are the steps in the budget process for Dawson County?
Well, the steps are pretty much determined by the chairman. He is the budget officer. So this year's process was a little bit different. We started it a little bit earlier. We started it in May. The chairman did his address, you know, to let everyone know it's time to start the budget process and everything. And then kind of gave everybody the, I guess, parameters of the budget process, what was going to happen. And then the departments all submitted their budgets to finance. And then we, in finance, we compile all that information for the chairman to go through. Then each of the departments this year, what made this process a little bit different was this year every department came before the full board. In years past, it was only the chairman and then the finance, the CFO, and then the budget manager that would sit with the chairman. But this year was a little bit different. They all came into public meetings. It's open to the public. Anyone could come. And all the department heads and all the constitutional officers, they presented their budget request to the full board, and not just to the chairman, it was to the full board. Then once those meetings took place, then everything that was compiled for the chairman, and he spent a lot of time going through every budget. I mean, he really went through with a fine-tooth comb looking at all the line items. He knew, you know, what everyone was asking for. And so then he compiled his proposed or recommended budget to the board of commissioners. And then after, I guess, discussions that they had, then they made their recommendations of what they wanted to see in the budget. I guess I need to back up too. Another part of this process is the revenue projections, and that's what we do in finance. We look at the trends of the revenue sources. We also work with the tax assessor to get an idea of what the tax digest is going to do for the year, you know, if we think it's going to go up or down or whatever, to try and get realistic numbers on what we're going to be able to afford to do. That's a big part of it, because just like in your own home, if you have money, then you can spend it, but you know, you try to live within your means. So that's another big part of the budget process. And then we had scheduled two public hearings. In my past experiences, I've always felt like it's best to have two public hearings, even though I think I'm required to have one. But then we ended up actually having three public hearings, and then the budget was adopted in September.
And did you also have a special call meeting related to the budget to entertain any additional comments?
Yes, sir.
And what particular area or areas was that intended to address? What department?
That was,
or was it just open?
The third hearing that they had was particularly for the sheriff to be able to come and you know, talk about what he needed and, you know, answer any questions that maybe the board might have about what his requests were.
Did the sheriff and his attorney, or both of them, did they appear at those meetings?
Yes, sir. They both did.
And going back a little bit farther in the process, the public meetings where officials and departments were allowed to present to the entire commission, as you described, roughly when did those occur? Best you can recall.
The public meetings?
Yes, before the public hearings, the public meetings where the department heads and officers and officials and agencies appeared.
Oh, I think those happened in June. I believe it was in June.
And before those took place, had the finance department, yourself and your staff, worked with department heads and officials, elected and otherwise, to help them develop their budget forms and the things that they needed to submit?
Yes, sir. We had the forms available for all the departments, and then once they put their budgets together, some of the departments maybe didn't have it fully put together, but they would schedule meetings with Natalie, our budget manager, and myself, and they would sit down with us, and we would kind of go through their budgets in order to make sure that, you know, they didn't miss anything, or that the numbers were right, or that they had things in the right line item, those types of things. But yeah, we had scheduled meetings with all the department heads and all the constitutional officers as well.
The point where you start having the public hearings as opposed to the public meetings. Do you recall roughly what time period those occurred over?
Those were in August, I believe, because the budget was adopted in September.
Did the package that was submitted by the sheriff differ from the simple budget forms that your office had prepared for everybody and worked with them to fill out and, as you said, get in the right line items and requests? Did the sheriff's office include something more or different?
Yes, sir. They included a lot of information. They included a notebook that I think gave a little more detail about things that they were requesting, but they did submit the correct forms as well.
I'm not going to ask you to go through all that, but as it's already in evidence, let me let me ask you in a general way, what is the general format of a budget? What does a budget consist of as a CFO would look at it and as a board might consider and finally approve it?
Your budget is, what it looks like is your revenues and your expenditures. And you have your list of revenue sources and what you are projecting that those revenue sources will amount to during that year. Then you also have your line items for each of the departments, and then each department has a total. Your revenues and your expenses have to balance for each fund.
And what funds would be considered among the revenue sources? What are the names and nature of those funds?
For the general fund, your largest revenue source is your property tax. In Dawson County, the next largest revenue source would be your local option sales tax, and this is just talking about general fund. You also have other taxes like alcohol taxes. You have fees like building permit fees. You also have, the insurance premium tax. That's another large source of revenue. But those are the majority of the, that's the main ones.
Are there some funds which are restricted in their use or how they can be appropriated or distributed?
In fund accounting, you do have restricted funds. The general fund is not considered a restricted fund, but you have other funds like your 911 fund is a restricted fund. You have your jail fund. Those funds are set aside for specific purposes, and that's what makes them a restricted fund. They have to be used for a specific purpose.
Are the local option sales tax funds restricted in sense like that?
The local option sales tax is not. It goes into your general fund to help offset your property tax. If you didn't have the local option sales tax, then your property tax would be higher in your general fund. Now the SPLOST is restricted. The SPLOST, the special purpose local option sales tax, it's restricted for the specific projects that are voted on by the citizens.
Can you do something with SPLOST money that is not included in what was approved in terms of the resolution and the ballot?
I don't believe that you should. I think that, you know, you should always try to stay with what the citizens vote for. Now there may be some, like if you say a building, you know, if you're going to do a building, then maybe you can add something to the building. I don't know. I think that's really more of a legal question than it would be for me to answer.
That's beyond you.
Yes.
What is fund balance?
Fund balance technically is the difference between your assets and your liabilities. And it shows up on the equity section of your financial statements. It works a little bit like retained earnings would in a business, but it's part of your equity, and how you add to your fund balance is if your revenues exceed your expenditures, then you add to your fund balance. So when people talk about, well, you're adding this money to fund balance, it's because your revenues exceeded your expenditures. So that's how that, or vice versa, if your expenditures exceed your revenues, then your fund balance will decrease. Fund balance is kind of a moving target. It continually changes. You know, usually in government, at the end of the fiscal year, you say, okay, this is what your fund balance is. However, that fund balance helps you operate through the end of the year, because if you don't have a healthy fund balance, then when you get to the part of your fiscal year where you're waiting on your property tax proceeds. A lot of governments have to go out and borrow money in short term. That's called a TAN, it's a tax anticipation note. And so if you have a healthy fund balance, then that keeps you from having to borrow that money short term. And it allows the county to operate without accumulating extra debt.
Does the fund balance have any function in terms of serving as a reserve for anything other than avoiding having to borrow?
Yes, it does. The last few years, Dawson County has used fund balance to balance their budget. They've committed to use a certain amount of dollars. If, you know, if everyone spends everything that's in their budget and the revenues come in the way they project, then the county will has obligated itself to use a portion of that fund balance in order to operate.
Is it recommended that a level of some sort be maintained from year to year in the general fund balance?
Yes, sir. The recommendation by the Government Finance Officers Association is, I believe, between 20 and 25%. Dawson County says that they want to maintain at least a minimum of a 15% fund balance. And what that is 15% of your expenditures. That's what that percentage means.
Over the last several years, roughly how have the fund balance numbers for the years generally trended?
During the downturn in the economy, the county actually had to use some of its fund balance. But the last couple of years, they've actually added to their fund balance. They did not have to use it, which was good because that helped to accumulate, you know, a larger balance.
In terms of that percentage that you referred to, from 15 to maybe 25%, what have been the rough trends there? As best you can estimate and recall.
May I look at a document?
Oh, sure.
In 2013, the county actually used $323,000 of its fund balance, which left it with a total fund balance of $5.3 million. And then there's something called total fund balance, and then there's unassigned. The unassigned portion of that fund balance is what is not obligated for something like budget or some prior obligations. In 2014, the county used $65,143 in fund balance. In 2015, the county added $976,146 to its fund balance, and in 2016, it added $1,240,940.
As a percentage of the total budget, in the sense that you talked about earlier, something in the 15 to 25% range, mm-hmm. over the last several years, has the fund balance tended towards the 15% end or the 25% end or something outside of those?
I believe, without looking at something, I believe it's been between 20 up to close to 25% I believe that's correct.
And in the 2018 fiscal year approved budget, what sort of fund balance are we looking at there?
It's projected that it would be at 15%.
The low end?
Yes, sir.
So to do anything else with fund balance towards use in your budget, you'd have to drop below 15%?
Yes, sir.
In the 2018 fiscal year budget, is there any projection to use some of that fund balance to make the budget work?
Yes, in 18,
yes,
it's projected that we will use $1,465,573.
And of course, you don't know yet how much of that you will end up actually having to use, but that is the projection?
Yes, sir, that's correct. That amount was needed to be projected in the budget in order to have a balanced budget.
Which you're required to do. Did you help the chairman in some way in compiling his proposal for the fiscal year 18 budget?
Yes, sir. Natalie and I sat down with him for, I think, a good part of the day, maybe a day and a half, and he went through every line item and told us what he wanted put into the budget for each line item, for each department. And then we went back and put it into the CSI system, that's the accounting software that we use. And so then once that was done, then we had his proposed budget. And then once his budget was put together, then we prepared the PowerPoint for him to present.
Show you what's been marked as exhibits R12 and R13. Mm-hmm. Ask you to identify those and explain those to the court, please.
Okay. Exhibit R12 is the general fund comparison by function. It shows the change in the budget from 2014 through 2018, and it's grouped by function, and by function I mean like function of government. Like you have general government, judicial, sheriff, public safety, public works, health and welfare, culture and recreation, planning and development, and then other financing uses. And it shows the total general fund budget, and this is the original adopted budget for each year. And then it shows the dollar change for each year, as well as the percentage.
And what is R13?
And R13 is just the pie charts that show the by function. It gives you that same information, but it's in a pie chart.
For
each of those years, for 2014 through 2018, and it's just general fund.
And in terms of those allocations, do the exhibits break down in terms of data, and then again in the pie chart fashion, what shares of the general fund budget went to, for example, the sheriff's office, the fire and EMS, public safety folks, and other departments and agencies?
Okay. It shows that for the most part, each one of these fiscal years, the sheriff's portion was either 28 or 29%. It looks like general government is roughly 20% each year. Judicial, it may vary by a percentage or two, 11%. Other public safety looks like it was about 17 to 19%. Public works is about 19 to 20. Health and welfare looks like it was 2 to 3%. Culture and recreation, which is your library and your parks and rec, is about 19 to 20%. and planning and development, 2 to 3%, and then other financing sources, anywhere from 5 to 7% for each of, you know, the average, kind of looking at each year.
Thank you. Once the board establishes a budget for a year, can it be changed during the course of the year to either change the overall numbers or to change allocations within the various departments or within a department or office?
Yes, sir, it can be changed.
How is that done?
Typically, if a department needs to move money from one line item to another, they will let finance know, and then depending upon the dollar amount, then we can do it, or the county manager has to approve it. Constitutional officer or elected official, they can move in between whatever line items they want to. They just let us know, and we try to make sure that, you know, what everyone, regardless of the department, that it's put into the correct line item. Because if it's not in the right line item, when the auditors come in, then they'll move it to the right line item. So we try to make sure it's put in the right line item.
You try to maintain the accounting.
Yes, sir. Proper. Keep it standard. Yes.
To focus in a touch more on the elected constitutional officials, such as the sheriff's office, how do they go about making moves or transfers or changes within their budget, either from a category to another, from a division to another, or from line items to other line items?
It's typically by email. They'll let us know what they need to move. Our accounting system that we have, CSI, it does not allow for us to write a check against an account that has no budget. So if there's not enough money for a check to be cut for a certain purchase, then we'll email the sheriff's office and say, we need to have a budget move. Please let us know, you know, where you want the money moved so we can pay this bill.
Were there any changes made in the course of 2017 to the budget by way of an amendment for any reason that came before the board?
Yes, sir. The budget was amended to allow for for salary increases. The board decided to have a salary study done, and so they wanted to implement the I guess the standards that salary study came up with, so everyone, for the most part, got a raise. And so the budget had to be amended in order to account for those raises.
And that required a formal consideration by the board?
Yes, sir.
Was a resolution done to give effect to that?
Yes, sir.
If the sheriff or other elected officials, at least the constitutional elected county officials, can move money around within their budgets, why do you put them in categories or line items to begin with?
It's part of better accounting practices that you have it in a line item. I think it also helps them better manage their budget, so they can see, you know, where their money's going and how much money they have left and what they've spent. It's also helpful for trend analysis.
did the finance department, you, yourself or your staff, determine what monies went into the sheriff's approved budget for 2018?
No, sir.
Who makes that determination?
The board.
Are part of the sheriff's funds restricted in the sense that he cannot move them around as opposed to a part that he can make transfers on his own accord?
Yes, the restricted funds, he can't really move those around, like for the inmate welfare, that has to stay in inmate welfare. The jail fund has to stay in the jail fund. Now, he could determine what he wanted to spend the money on, but it couldn't be transferred like from the inmate welfare fund to the general fund.
In terms of the general fund, can he move money around within the general fund between salaries and purchases or contracting work?
Yes, sir.
Can he move around monies between different personnel and their salaries and benefits and other personnel salaries and benefits?
Yes, sir.
Is the general fund the largest, the smallest, or what portion of his budget?
It's the largest portion.
Substantially so?
Yes, sir.
Did he get an increase in the 2018 general fund portion of his budget as compared with the 2017
yes.
general fund portion of his budget?
Yes, sir.
Did his overall budget from all sources, restricted and unrestricted general fund, increase from fiscal year 2017 to the approved 2018 budget?
Yes.
Was it cut overall from 2017 to 2018?
No, sir. I believe all of his line items were either the same or higher than for 18 than they were for 17, with the exception of fuel. And we took all the departments, the chairman and commissioners decided to take a portion of what had previously been budgeted in fuel for all the departments and move it into a fuel contingency, so that if there was a spike in fuel or the cost, then you know that those funds would be available. But I believe every line item was either the same or higher than for 18 as it was for 17.
That's the best you recall at this point?
That's the best I can recall at this point.
With respect to fuel, then, was the number smaller for 18?
Yes, that was the one line item that the number was smaller.
Okay, and again, why was it smaller?
Because the board decided to take the fuel money from all the departments that used fuel and put it into, they reduced their budgets. I mean, they still had money in their budget for fuel, but they reduced those budgets and put the fuel, that extra fuel money, into a contingency.
And what was the basis for making that reduction in the first place? What was the rationale there?
I believe the board felt like that was the best use of the resource. I don't know, you might have to verify that with them.
Well, let me ask you this. Had the county's fleet, including the sheriff's office, been using the amount that had been appropriated in the recent past for fuel?
No, they had never used all the amount that in years past had been allocated for fuel.
If the sheriff's department finds that it needs more fuel than dollars are allocated for that purpose in the 18 budget, is there a mechanism to address that within the budget?
Oh, yes. They can ask to have that money transferred to their budget, so that way they could pay for the fuel, that if they used up all the available funds, and they could have that money transferred to use.
Where would it come from?
It would come from that contingency.
Were, and again, were there any significant cuts to any of the line items other than that one?
Not that I can recall this time.
Pardon me if I've already asked you this. Who had the largest, which office or department had the largest share of the overall county fiscal year 2018 budget?
The sheriff.
Who had the largest general fund share?
The sheriff.
How has the ad valorem tax collection situation tended to change over the last several years in terms of availability of that money to go into the general fund?
It's had a significant impact on Dawson County's general fund budget, because during the downturn in the economy, properties were devalued. So I believe there's a chart in the annual report that shows, I believe it was in 2008, the property tax was at a little over 12 million. And so it went down to, I want to say close to 8 million. But now it is on its way back up, but we still have not reached the level of property tax that we were at in previous years. We're still not to that point yet.
Let me show you what's marked as Exhibit R14 and ask you to tell the court what that is.
This is a spreadsheet showing the budgets for each of the departments in each of the funds for Dawson County from 2014 to 2018. And what it shows is the difference in their budgets, like from one year to the next.
Does it reflect a percentage as well as a dollar amount change?
Yes, sir.
Is that a general fund or overall budget, including all funds?
It's all funds.
Looking at the sheriff's portion of that, what sort of change occurred from 2017 to the approved 18 budget, percentage-wise, what kind of increase? Talking about the sheriff's.
Okay. Well, he has different departments, so we'd have to add those together. Mm-hmm. From 17, in just the general sheriff's office, he has a 6.6% increase from 16 to 17. And then a 7.20% change from 17 to 18.
How about in the K-9 department?
K-9 saw a decrease in 17 of $8,150, but then there was an increase of 6,000 in 2018, or 27.59%. In the jail, there was an increase from 16 to 17 of $170,482, or 6.48%. And then from 17 to 18, it was $167,931 increase, or 5.99%. School resource officers, there was a decrease of $1,085 from 16 to 17, and then a $63,046 increase from 17 to 18, or 26.02%. Sheriff services, court services, from 16 to 17, there was a decrease of $2,807, and then an increase of $83,744 from 17 to 18, or 12.56%.
So the range and percentage among those different divisions of the sheriff's office, as I see it there, ran from 5.99% for the jail increase for 18.
Yes.
Up to 27.59%, which was the K-9, although that's a smaller overall dollar number.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
With respect to the largest portions of the sheriff's budget, would that be the jail and the sheriff offices accounts?
Yes, that would be the two largest.
And the jail went up by what, 5.99%, am I reading correctly?
Yes, that's correct, or $167,931.
And the sheriff's account went up by how much?
$222,260, or 7.20%.
What was the source of the largest portion of the general fund budget increase for the sheriff's office for 2018?
It was to implement the increases that came from the salary study, as well as the increases for health insurance.
Is that something peculiar to the sheriff's office, or was that true of other departments?
No, that was countywide. Every department had to see an increase in their budget in order to accommodate for those increases.
That's all I have of this witness.
Let me ask, if you had a budget where you had legitimate needs from the sheriff or anybody else, but obviously the legitimate request, but there just simply is not enough money in the funds available in preparing a budget to accommodate that, and the only solution is if you authorize money for something that is obviously needed, then what sources, where would there be a source of any increased funds to do that, aside from the reserves in the general fund?
If you could not use your reserves, or if you had no reserves, I guess you have to go to the bank and borrow the money. I mean, that's the only
thing. Or raise taxes, is that
right? Or raise taxes, yeah, you could do that too.
How would that be done, do you know?
The board would have to make that decision to raise taxes.
Like the ad valorem rates or something like that?
Yes, sir, they would adjust the millage rate.
Okay, all right. Anything else?
I don't believe so.
All right. How long we've been going? I sort of lost track of time.
It flies when we're having fun, doesn't it, Judge? Yeah. I think we've been going a couple of hours.
Okay. Let's take, let me ask, it's approaching noon. How much longer, how many more witnesses, and how long do you think they'll be, Mr. Frey?
I may only have one more witness. I know I'm going to have one, and it will take at least as long as Ms. Neikirk.
Okay.
Of course, I can't account for how long Mr. Homans will need for his cross-examination.
Okay. You going to have any rebuttal?
I may. Okay. Right now, I would say no. But.
Okay. Well, I'm kind of glad, just pushing on through lunch. I don't contemplate a lunch break unless it becomes necessary. All right, let's take, we'll take 15 minutes at this point, and then we'll recommence and go on, get on through it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. See you in red.
Thank you. Ms. Neikirk, as you described, y'all went through a process to help the chairman, Billy, to establish his budget presentation, correct?
That's correct.
And prior to that time, you had these public meetings where folks like the sheriff's office and other departments came to the full commission and presented their budgets, right?
That's correct.
And that, and before that, that's when they had met with your office, you and Natalie, to go over their budget.
Yes, sir.
All right. And in your budget, you include the phrase requested and recommended. You know those two phrases.
Yes, sir.
And do you ever establish or insert the recommended numbers on behalf of the county?
The recommended
numbers? Recommended numbers.
I think what happens is when we go through some of the line items, there's like a, Natalie will look at the trend and see what the trend is, and she'll put that in there as a recommendation.
Right.
However, the chairman
right.
changes that
or
quite often.
Or the board, right?
Or the board, yes,
right.
sir.
But in this case, that's what you did, is you and your office or folks under your direction put in some recommended numbers, right?
But we never add like big things. You know, we look at the trend.
Right.
You know, like if somebody's asking for, I don't know, a $25,000 item or something, we don't include that into the recommendation or anything like that because that's up to the board to make that determination.
And in this case, as to the sheriff's budget, your office gave him the recommended numbers that your office was going to insert the morning they came over to present to the Board of Commissioners on July the 5th of 2017.
Can you say that again?
In this case, in connection with the Sheriff's Office budget for 2018, you all gave him, that is you and your office, gave the recommended numbers from your department the morning of July 5, 2017, as they were coming in to meet with the full Board of Commissioners.
I remember us meeting with him, but I honestly don't remember if the recommended numbers were already in there or not.
Or whether you gave those to him on July the 5th. You just don't remember.
I don't. I'm sorry.
All right. And you've described the tedious process that the chairman went through to put together his recommended budget, right?
Yes, sir.
You worked very hard, as I believe your phrase was, he went through it with a fine-tooth comb.
He did, yes, sir.
And then he walked into a meeting of the Board of Commissioners. Is that showing up on your screen?
Yes, sir.
And this is what he presented, right?
Yes.
And that date is August the 10th of 2017, correct?
Yes, sir.
And there was, in accord with the processes as you prescribed, there were to be public hearings, and the first was scheduled for August the 17th, 2017, correct?
I believe so.
All right, now at this time, were y'all merely approving the budget, or were you approving the budget and the millage rate?
I think it was just the budget. I don't remember.
All right, and the, just for purposes of our record, can you tell us what a millage rate is?
Yes, sir. Millage rate is the rate that the citizens are taxed upon for their personal property and their real estate. It's called a millage rate because it's based on thousands.
Okay, and if the digest goes up, that is your overall value of the property in the county that's subject to taxation, that goes up, your real property, but your millage rate stays the same, then the law deems that a tax increase, correct?
That is correct.
All right. And that's what happened for Dawson County in 2017, which funds the 2018 budget. Is that correct?
Yes.
So the real property tax digest, the ad valorem tax digest went up.
Yes, sir.
But as you recall, the millage rate stayed the same.
That's correct.
That's still deemed a tax increase.
Yes, it is.
All right. So then you've described on direct the public meetings that were held regarding this budget, right?
Yes, sir.
Until it was ultimately approved on September the 21st of 2017.
Yes, sir.
All right. I'm going to show you a document that contains changes, and this has been put in, Judge, with our Exhibit 13, I'm sorry, our Exhibit 14, and I believe it's also included as one of the exhibits that Ms. Frey has offered. Now, I want to focus here at the bottom. I'll have to turn it this way, I think, to make it to where we can read it. Try one other way here, if I can get it where you can read it. Right here, the board would like to put forth the suggestion that if the departments and offices funded by the county continue to do a great job of staying under budget for 2017 and revenue continues upward trend, a 2% salary increase could be added to the budget in April 2018. That would be a year since the salary study changes were implemented, right?
Yes, sir.
Did you prepare this document, Ms. Neikirk?
Yes, I did.
All right. And you put that language in. Did you come up with that language, or were those instructions given to you?
Those were instructions.
All right. And those were instructions were proposed changes to the 2018 budget by the board.
Yes, sir.
And you sent that out on August the 11th, correct?
If you say that's the date, yep. I sent it.
Yeah, I want you to testify today. So y'all had a hearing on August the 17th, correct?
I believe so.
And you mentioned about how the sheriff and I were able to attend y'all's meetings and have discussions, correct?
Yes, sir.
And this letter dated August 17, 2017, from my office, correct?
This letter is from your office? I'm not sure what you're asking.
I'm asking if you're referring to an exhibit.
This is attached to my complaint. That's in the record. And within there, we go through some concerns about when the public hearings are scheduled, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. And references that we received an email August the 11th containing a list of proposed changes to the FY 2018 budget. Right?
Yes, sir.
Those proposed changes were not discussed in any public meeting after the chairman presented his budget presentation on August the 10th, and these changes were recommended on August the 11th. Is that correct?
I honestly am not sure about the dates. I mean, I know those changes were made after the chairman made his proposed presentation. So, right. But I don't know exact for the dates. I'm sorry.
All right. Tell the judge when these changes, and there's 20 changes or so here, aren't they?
Yes, sir.
All right. When those proposed changes were made, they were never initially discussed in a public meeting. They were merely adopted as part of the approved budget on September the 21st. Is that correct?
I think that's correct. I mean, these changes came about from recommendations that other board members wanted. So that was where these recommendations came from.
All right, and I understand your answer. And the other board members, you told us on direct, it came from Commissioner Nix and Commissioner Gaines. Were there other board members who made changes that are inserted here?
I'm not sure. I think they had other outside conversations that I was not a part of.
All right, but you were a part of the conversation in your office and instructed, as you told us, to make these changes.
Yes, sir.
And all of that occurred in your office and did not occur at a public meeting.
That's correct.
And that was after the chairman had gone through the tedious process of combing through to make his presentation, right?
Yes, sir.
All right, and would you agree with me that these changes that were first announced in your office ultimately became the budget, the changes to the budget that were approved a month later?
I believe that's correct, okay, sir.
And the initial that you've described, the hearings that you understand are required for a budget, you said only one's required, but you usually recommend two, but that in this case there were three, correct?
Yes, sir.
What happened was that the initial hearing scheduled for August the 17th didn't qualify, did it, as a proper public hearing?
I don't know.
You don't know? And isn't it true that the enacting legislation requires that the chairman's budget, which he did on the 10th, has to be noticed and provided to the public for a specific period of time before the public hearing is proper, right?
I believe it was put on the website.
Okay, but it has to be advertised, correct?
Yes, sir.
In the newspaper, and they missed that deadline, right?
I'm not aware of us missing a deadline.
You're not aware of an issue come down, the advertisement for the August 17 public hearing did not publish until August 9. Budget was not published until August 11th, therefore it fails to meet the requirements of being provided notice at least 10 days before the hearing. You're just not aware of that?
No, I mean, I know that you have to have it advertised, but we had the other hearings as well, so I felt like that covered it.
And I understand, that's what I'm asking. It was your testimony, there were three hearings to discuss the budget.
Yes, sir.
All right, and those three hearings, the first was August the 17th, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
And then there was another public hearing, just an open public hearing, and then you described a special public meeting for the sheriff to come over, right?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, and you attended all of those.
Yes, sir.
All right. And so the one that involved the sheriff's presentation and was specific to the sheriff, as you've described, that was held on September the 19th, just 2 days before the September 21st adoption, correct?
I believe so.
All right. Now, at that public meeting, the minutes that were kept are just action minutes, right? In other words, they don't go through the specific of what each speaker states, correct?
That's correct.
All right. And at that public meeting, do you recall Commissioner Nix discussing at length with the sheriff a January of 2017 order that his office had made? Do you recall that at all?
I do. I recall her discussing something that was ordered.
From January of 2017 that she discussed with the sheriff on September the 19th of 2017, some 8 months later.
I'm sorry, I'm drawing a blank.
Okay. Had you ever discussed that January 2017 bill with the sheriff during this tedious process to develop this budget.
What was the bill for?
Well, I'm asking you, have you ever discussed a January 2017 bill with Sheriff Johnson throughout this process to create his budget?
I honestly don't recall.
All right. And do you recall Commissioner Fawcett accusing the sheriff of taking action that breached a warrant?
I remember her asking something about, was it an HVAC unit? I believe it was an HVAC unit. I think it was something about the HVAC unit warranty.
And tell the judge when that HVAC unit was repaired.
I think it was January.
All right.
I think it was January.
And so she brought that up for the first time, to your knowledge, to Sheriff Johnson on September the 19th, 2017, 2 days before they were to vote on his 18 budget. Right?
I believe so.
All right. And then, again, this is attached to our petition. Sheriff requested specific information regarding the claim asserted that from the commissioners during the proceeding on September 19 that the sheriff's office somehow voided a warranty. When and how? Were you ever directed to provide any information to the sheriff's office regarding the claims that he somehow affected a warranty?
No, sir.
And to your knowledge, no information was provided to the sheriff to support any such claim?
No, sir. That would not be something that would come from my office anyway. I don't
it would not?
Not the warranty part. No,
all right.
Sir.
Well, what about any notice about a purchase or an expenditure? That would come from you, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, do you also recall during that meeting on September the 19th of questions being posed by Commissioner Fawcett about vendor gifts to the sheriff's office and being concerned about Pyrex plates being provided to the sheriff's office as a result of the size of order they had made?
I don't remember that.
But that was at least a good part of the dialogue, as you described it, that occurred between the sheriff and at least two of the commissioners on September the 19th. Was the bill from January, the HVAC work from January, and Pyrex plates?
Your Honor, I think that the witness's testimony is being mischaracterized. She just said she didn't know.
You have a redirect.
You can answer.
I remember the part about the warranty being, you know, mentioned, but I really don't remember the part about the Pyrex plates.
Okay. So that at least adds to, but you do remember about the bill from Commissioner Nix from January of 2017?
Yes, sir.
All right. So as to those two items, that was, would you agree that that was a significant part of what you characterize as the dialogue between the commissioners and the sheriff's office at that meeting on September the 19th?
To the best of my knowledge,
all right.
Yes.
Now, when the chairman presented his recommendations, he did a comparison there for us from FY18 proposed and FY2017, and I put it up here on the board as part of one of our exhibits, Judge. You would agree with me, would you not, that this comparison is from the initial approved FY2017 budget?
That's correct.
And it does not include the amendments to the 2017 budget that were made in April of 2017.
That is correct.
And as of the time that this comparison was given, the FY 2017 budget had been amended, but those numbers are not provided here.
That is correct.
All right. Now, in the chain of command over at the county, you report to County Manager Headley, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. And there had been times prior to this budget being presented, but going back into the spring of 2017, when the sheriff would seek to have a certain payment made and your office would notify Mr. Headley that the request violated the county policies that you must follow, correct?
Yes, sir.
And explain to him you understood the sheriff may be able to approve that, but you needed some direction from him, right?
That's correct.
All right, were you ever informed or did you ever receive a copy of the memorandum that Mr. Headley sent to the sheriff that stated June 5th of 2017 regarding the status of purchasing and personnel decisions?
I don't believe I received a copy of this, but I think I have seen it.
All right. So what were the circumstances under which you saw it?
I believe Mr. Headley showed me the
card. Right. In here it says, that if the sheriff and his staff didn't handle contractual and other arrangements, he does so, and your office does so on its own, they'll have appropriate policies in place, trained staff to enable you to stay in compliance with all applicable Georgia and federal statutes, etc. You see all that?
Yes, sir.
All right. And can you tell the judge, did you ever report to Mr. Headley that there was any issue with what the sheriff was requesting you to do other than the county policies?
No, sir. Our problem was trying to make sure that we were following policy, and sometimes we were not able to.
Right. Move in here. Do you have anything to do with what's referenced as other legal pitfalls come up in recruitment, hiring? Is any of that under your direction or control?
No, sir. That's under HR.
HR. All right. Now, if Mr. Headley went over this with you, were you given a copy of our reply that was dated June the 20th?
I don't remember seeing this.
All right. Down here, let it settle. Sheriff and I suggest that appropriate forms be prepared to present to county staff to allow the sheriff to exercise the authority granted by law without preemption by any conflicting county ordinance or policy. Were you ever consulted by Mr. Headley about participating in creating whatever form would allow you to proceed with the sheriff's office request?
No, sir, I don't believe so.
Now, when the budget was approved, let's see if your office is this a form that your office creates? I know it's hard to read,
yes,
but it is the form y'all create.
All right. Yes,
now, this Neikirk, I want to go right here. The
going to look at the number $600,000, okay?
Yes.
And if we scroll up, that's under the SPOS 6, right?
Right.
Okay. And as you've testified, those funds are funds that the voters approved. In this case, the voters had approved that in 2015, right?
Yes, sir.
And so actually, 14 started collecting in 15, right?
That's correct.
And it's used for those specific purposes, correct?
That's correct.
And that's one of those funds that the sheriff doesn't have complete discretion over these SPLOST funds, does he?
That's correct.
And in fact, that is voted on, the amount to be spent, and in what purpose has to be voted on and approved by the Board of Commissioners.
That's right.
All right. Now, in this case, in the verified answer that we have, but the response that we receive says that, let me start with paragraph 5 first. Says that petitioner is the sheriff, submitted a proposed budget for the sheriff's office for 18 by the Board of Commissioners, and that petitioner requested a sum in excess of $8.9 million for general fund and capital combined, and claimed that the total budget request was for $530,498, and show that the sheriff's total approved budget was $9,173,080. You see that?
Yes, sir.
And if we go to paragraph 8, we have the same number, which provided the sheriff's office with allocation of 2018 expenditures in the total amount of $9,173,080. Right?
I see that, yes, sir.
All right. And down here says that the sheriff is entitled to move fund around between the line items and divisions within his approved budget. The amount was previously shown to us, the approved budget, according to this answer, is 9-1, which he knows has done and has been encouraged by the board to do, and that he still has that authority, right?
Yes, sir.
And if we go back to this, I'm happy to provide you with a calculator. But I'll tell you that there's been prior testimony that the total column over here for sheriffs, just for sheriffs, minus the 260 where there's a restriction. That's in the capital projects fund, and that's what the board restricted pursuant to those changes, correct?
Yes.
And minus these grant funds, 112,204 and 4,040, minus the 15,000 that was removed for SWAT, that these totals for sheriff services comes out to 9,173,080, and that would include the SPLOST. And he does not have discretion to move that around. Is that correct?
Your Honor, can I ask that he clear that up, the question? He said that doesn't have discretion to move that around. What it is that's being referred to as not movable.
Yeah, go ahead. Thank you. He doesn't
doesn't have discretion to move $600,000 between line items, right?
It's my understanding, because it's SPOS, then it has to be spent for the purpose that the voters voted on.
All right. And SPOS money cannot be spent for salaries or for personnel items, can it?
That's correct.
The SPOS collections for 2017 were up 16.35% compared to 2016. Is that right?
I believe that's close. I don't have anything in front of me to look at.
Your office publishes a finance monthly report. You do that every month, right?
Yes, sir.
Available online.
Mm-hmm.
Does this look like, I know we put some writing on it, but does this look like the form that you all create?
Yes, that's part of the key indicator report.
All right. And that shows that the SPLOST collections were up 16.35%?
Compared to 16, yes, sir.
And up 18.72 over projections?
Yes, sir.
That the local option sales tax, which goes into the general fund, is at 16.35% above compared to 2016, right?
Yes, sir.
All right. And because you have an agreement with this SPLOST, the SPLOST will run for 6 years and won't be capped at the amount set forth in the resolution, correct?
It was my understanding, yes, that it would not be capped.
Okay, so if the projections are up, it's an indication that there may be more SPLOS money when this expires in 2021, that there may be SPLOS money available for capital project items, correct?
That's correct.
The CAD system qualifies as a capital project item, doesn't it?
It is a capital project item.
And in this SPLOS, this is part of our Exhibit 1, Your Honor. The SPLOS that was approved by the Board of Commissioners and by them approved in the referendum by the voters provides for the Sheriff's Office to receive $3,883,000, right?
That's the estimated, yes.
All right. And if that's divided by six, then of course that number exceeds $600,000 annually, correct?
Yes, sir.
Right. Now, being in the finance office with the county, you're aware of in other words, the county, the overall health of the county, y'all collect and you receive. And Dawson County receives, and it was on one of the pie charts, but the total revenue coming into the county, to the general fund, coming from sales tax money is approximately 42%. Is that correct?
I believe that's close.
All right, go ahead. Do you have something there? I saw you getting ready to look at something.
Let's see.
All right. Well, hang on. I think we've got
Ben, do you have something? Don't I have something back there that shows you the percentage?
We've got them. We've got y'all's exhibits.
Oh, okay. Lynn, if you'll hand me the budget book, I know it's in there.
Let me find
that. Yeah, it's in the budget book.
Well, but you had some updated ones from there, didn't you? Or no?
Well, this will show the 18 budget, what the percentages are, as far as what we budgeted, you know, for what, are you talking about for revenue sources?
Revenue sources.
Yeah.
I'm gonna give you, well, not all of that specific.
Yeah. That's, yes, that's it, thank you.
Just tell us what page you're on.
Sure.
This is the budget guide or the budget book?
This is the budget book that we just, we have published and then we sent to GFOA.
And what's it say on the front of the box?
2018 budget guide, it's R10.
Yeah. And just give us a page?
Mm-hmm, on page 20.
Just a second.
All right, for general fund, yeah. Property taxes, almost 42%, and sales tax is 25.6.
And other taxes?
Mm-hmm, that's usually includes the alcohol taxes and the insurance premium tax.
All right, and so when these are, these two numbers are combined, you're, looks like about 38.9% comes from the local option sales tax and other taxes. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And that the ad valorem property taxes fund significantly less than 50% of the general fund. Is that correct?
41.9%.
Okay. And in most counties, the ad valorem property tax is 50% or greater. Would you agree with that?
In my experience, yes.
All right. And in any case, that's an indication of the commercial retail strength of Dawson County. Is that correct?
That is correct.
All right. And in fact, in 2017, the new Kroger Shopping Center opened, correct?
Yes, sir.
And the Public Shopping Center across the street opened, correct?
Yes, sir.
These are major commercial retail developments within Dawson County that recently opened, right?
That is correct.
All right, and we also have the outlet mall, which opened back some 20, 23 years ago, which is another major retail commercial center within the county, right?
Yes, sir.
All right. And that in part is an explanation for why the increase in the special purpose local option sales tax revenue and the local option sales tax revenue has increased, right?
Yes, sir.
And do you receive any numbers there within your office about what the estimate, or do you have a way to run an estimate of what that indicates of the number of people who are coming to do business here in Dawson County as compared to the residential population?
No, sir, I don't have anything like that. That would probably come from the chamber.
Okay, or an economic development.
Development, something like that.
But you would agree that, based upon your knowledge and experience, that the resident population would not support those commercial retail centers on their own?
Oh, I totally agree with that, yes.
In the course of the entire budget presentation, do you know if there was any part of the budget presentation that included the numbers based upon the amended 2017 budget?
No, sir, it was all on original budget. The comparisons were original, and that's typical.
But within the chairman's presentation, he indicated that there would be no new positions. Is that correct?
I believe at the initial presentation there were no new positions, but there was a position added later on. by the time it was finally adopted.
I'll ask you about that, give me just a second. This is his presentation, part of the chairman's presentation. Proposed budget highlights no new positions, right?
That's correct.
Okay. But if you use only the initial approved 2017 budget, then there would have been two positions added for the planning department pursuant to a budget amendment in April. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So this portion of the budget presentation includes the 2017 budget amendment.
Yes, because when we do the, when we put the budget together, we use position control, and that gives us the number of people and their pay at the, current pay. And so that's how we come up with those numbers for the salary costs.
I understand. But you didn't use the numbers from the budget amendment, only the fact that the positions had been added pursuant to a budget amendment.
Say that again, sorry.
You didn't use the numbers for comparison from the 2017 budget amendment, but you used the fact that positions were added pursuant to a budget amendment.
We used the dollar amount of the salary. We used the updated salaries that came about from the salary study. So that's what was put in the budget, was the updated salary.
But if what that number was not included for the purposes of the comparison between 17 and 18.
Right.
All right. Now, that's all I'm asking.
Yeah, it's in the budget. It just wasn't in the, the 17.
Comparison.
Yes, in the budget.
But I'm just trying to make sure I understand that you did include within the chairman's presentation where he says no new positions, that did include an amendment in 2017 to add two positions to plan.
Yes.
All right. Now, you were telling me that there were other positions added by the Board of Commissioners when they finally approved the budget on September the 21st.
I believe those positions were added prior to.
I'm sorry, I may have confused you. The planning positions were added pursuant to an April 2017 budget amendment, April the 20th.
Yes.
There were other positions outside of planning department. There were other positions in the fire department that were also approved when the Board of Commissioners approved the budget on September the 21st, correct?
There were nine positions that were funded by the SAFER grant.
All right. And also by drawing funds out of fund balance to fund the county's portion of that, correct?
Yes, sir.
Of approximately $150,000.
I believe that's correct.
So the commissioners exercised their discretion to withdraw from approximately $150,000 from fund balance to fund nine fire department positions.
Yes, sir.
And currently, pending before the Board of Commissioners is a request for funding of the Development Authority of they've asked for $175,000, correct?
That's correct.
And currently pending out of the 18 budget is to withdraw from fund balance to fund it for $135,000, correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. And currently, the county is advertising for an emergency services director position, another position over emergency services, correct?
No, sir. That position is in the budget. It's and there's a person currently in that position. They've just done some restructuring, and that person is stepping back. But this won't be an addition to the budget.
All right, but I'm asking, they're currently advertising for this position, right?
Yes, sir.
And if there's any other funds needed, that would have to come out of fund balance.
Yes, sir, but it's not anticipated that there will be additional funds.
All Would you agree with me, Ms. Neikirk, that the sheriff did not receive an increase in his budget of close to $1 million from 2017 to 2018?
Did you restate the question?
Would you agree with me that the sheriff did not receive an increase of close to $1 million over the 17 budget?
No.
Okay.
I would not agree. I would say that based on the 2017 budget, the original approved budget, compared to what was approved in 2018, I show that the change was $985,277.
All right. And first, you want to go back to the original approved budget. But that budget was amended, was it not?
Yes, sir.
And then as a result of that amendment in 2017, the sheriff's 2017 budget was increased.
That's correct.
And so what you want to testify to is the original approved budget rather than the amended budget, right? Final budget.
Yes, sir.
And the final budget with those amendments increased the sheriff's 2017 budget by approximately $362,000, didn't it?
Yes, sir.
All right. And so if you back that out of your $985,000 estimate, that would back that up to 600 and some odd thousand, correct?
Okay.
Is that correct?
I believe so.
All right. And what you're including in his approved budget includes the $260,000 that's in a capital project fund that's restricted, correct?
Yes, sir.
And he has no control over that money.
That's right.
So that should be backed out of that $600,000 that you say has increased his budget.
He's still getting the funds, even though he doesn't have, because the comparison from the prior year includes capital. So when you're comparing one year to the next, you want to include all the funds that were included in what he was allocated for.
All right. Let me ask you this though. It's restricted. So you amended the budget in 17. And so there's nothing that would prevent the Board of Commissioners from amending the 18 budget and removing that 260 from the budget. Sheriff would have nothing to do about that. Nothing he could control the way the budget is approved.
I personally can't see the board doing that.
I understand, but they could.
Yes, sir.
All right. And then that $260,000 is so restricted, it's not to be used at all in 2018, is it?
The purpose for that money was for the new CAD system. And the way the board, I guess, structured this is they wanted that money set aside. And then the following year, they would add an additional $260,000, and that would provide the full funding for the new CAD system.
Okay. So that money won't be used at all in 2018, will it?
No, sir.
All right. And as we've gone through with the total budget for the sheriff, it includes SPLOST money of $600,000 that he has no control over, does he?
Well, no, sir. I mean, he orders the cars that he wants, so that's his control over it. I mean, we don't tell him what kind of cars to order or anything. I mean, he orders what he wants. But as far as being able to do something else with it, I don't believe. I mean, like I said, I think that's a legal interpretation as far. I know there's been some question about where it says equipment, so I'm not qualified to answer that question.
All right. But the county's answer says that he has control over $9,100,000 as we've gone through in their answer, correct?
Well, that's the dollar amount that has been approved for his use.
Been approved for his use, but he doesn't have discretion over it, right?
He does over a lot of it. The general fund portion, he has discretion over.
I'm asking you about the SPLOST money. He doesn't have control over that.
No, sir.
Thank you.
Redirect.
Just briefly. During the course of 2017, did you come to understand that the sheriff can engage in purchases and contracting, having work done, buying things, changing his payroll decisions around, all without having to follow the Dawson County policies and procedures? Is it your understanding that he can do that?
Yes, sir.
Nonetheless, is it important for your office that those decisions be communicated to you and your staff so that the changes, even if they're not done according to Dawson County policy, that those changes are communicated to your office for purposes of such things as writing checks to vendors, doing payroll checks, whatever it takes in terms of accounting? Is it important that those decisions he makes be effectively communicated to your office?
Yes, sir, very important.
Mr. Homans asked you about the $173,080 budget figure for the sheriff. And he asked that, asked whether or not all of that was subject to the sheriff's discretion, including $600,000 for SPOST. And as I recall, your answer was that it wasn't all subject to his discretion.
That's correct.
If you take that figure, the $9,173,080, and take out the $600,000 SPOS money from 18, use a calculator if you need to, but taking that 600 out, would that still leave a large amount of money subject to his discretion?
Yes, sir.
Unrestricted money that he can do what he chooses to do.
Yes, sir.
That figure, the $9,173,080, already had removed from it the $260,000 capital, the $112,204, and the $15,000 that he asked you to take out. That's where that $9,173,000 came from, right?
Yes, sir.
So if you take the $600,000 SPOS out from that figure, you end up with $8,573,080. $8,600,000, correct?
Please,
and feel free to calculate it by hand or with a calculator or anything that helps you.
Yes, that would be correct.
So what he's left with is, just for the record, $8,573,080 that are subject to his discretion in terms of the decisions about how to spend it.
Yes, sir.
In making your revenue projections for sales tax purposes, did you consider that the new development in commercial and retail would have some impact on what kind of projections to make?
Yes, we did. In years past, we had never reached the amount that had been projected. And so the chairman asked that we really look hard at the local option sales tax numbers. And so we tried to put in a more realistic number. So, you know, I understand that there's a lot of growth down here at 400. There's a lot of retail. We're very grateful for that because it provides a great revenue source. But what people have to keep in mind that it takes $10 million in new sales to get $100,000 in sales tax. So that's a lot of extra sales, you know, to, you know, $100,000 is a lot of money, but when you're looking at a $30 million government, it doesn't go very far.
In making those projections back in the middle up through September 21st, 2017, did you take into account the best numbers that you had available for where sales tax collections were trending?
Yes, we did.
And again, it's all estimates other than looking back at the historical collections.
Right.
Anything you put in a budget for next year or for now this year is a projection.
That's correct.
It's an estimate. Is that correct?
That is correct.
I think that's all I have for this witness.
Green Cross?
No, thank you.
You can come down.